Hello there. Welcome to Reason. Let's just reason together. I'm Ronnie again. I'd like to continue my talk about body, soul, and spirit. I'm sorry, I was kind of tired and was busy today, and everything just goes crazy. But you know, I'm happy. I'm back over here again. I'd like to say before I start that, generally speaking, I use the when it comes to the Bible, I use the King James from the 1900s, and the New King James, and the New American Standard. I believe it's easier to understand the language and everything else. So, I hope you understand that. So, let's start already over here with what I show you. You know, right behind me about body, soul, and spirit. The question is, you know, when you look at Genesis, 1:26-27, where God says, you know, we are created in His image, right? And a lot of people don't understand what does it mean, what it means to be created in His image, okay? So, actually what it really means, God's image means that humans share, though imperfectly and finitely, in God's nature, that is, in His communicable attributes, life, personality, truth, wisdom, love, holiness, justice, and so have the capacity for spiritual fellowship with Him. A lot of people don't understand why God created also human beings. Well, to tell you the truth, when you really study it, God has a reason for it, and actually what we call is the clock is ticking, more or less. God has a reason. He has a beginning and an end. That's why it's so important to understand the whole Bible from Genesis all the way back to Revelation. And I'd like to share also real quick about God, who really God is, what He says He is, okay? When I look at the scriptures, for instance, in Isaiah 43:10, He keeps saying, okay, that you are not known. And believe me, and understand that I am He. Before me, there was no God. So here, He's trying to emphasize, okay, that God is the only one. If you go back also to Isaiah 44:5-6, and you look at it real closely, look what He said over there. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and the Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, I am the last. Beside me, there is no God. So here it goes, He repeated again, He's the only one. And when you go to Isaiah 45:5, look what it says. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God beside me. I will gird you through, you have not known me. Here He repeats again, there is only one God, one true God. And a lot of people, you know, when I talk to people about God, they get confused. They say, well, who is really the true God? When you go through the scripture, in a nice way, I would say, so in the Old Testament especially, God is talking to, He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So that's the beginning, I would say, so important to know. And I thought something to share with you also in Isaiah 46:9-10. Because that goes again, what is the reason, why is the reason God created us? But look what He says in verse 9. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. Verse 10, He says over here, declaring the end from the beginning, and from the ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. So here again, God is trying to say that what He did in the creation and everything else, He has a reason, and He has His will. He's all-powerful, but yet in the same token, as He created us, And I share with you, you know, already some of the attributes, so to speak, that he shared with us to communicate with him through life, personality, truth, wisdom, love, holiness, justice, so that we can, what? Have fellowship with him. When you look at it in the end, but when it comes to the scriptures, he mentioned also the word, they use the word, you know, a child to become a son of a daughter of God. We are adopted. He wants to share his holiness with us. So he wants a relationship. And here's the difference between religion. Okay, may I say so? Religion is actually, the definition of a religion, generally speaking, is that man seeketh after God or like to please God. And God says, you cannot do that. I'm the one who created you. I will show you my way. And I show you also my commandments and what I expect from you. So here it's very important to understand the beautiful part, why we are created, okay? So when you look at the word, excuse me, you know, what, it's me over here. I'm so far ahead with my thinking that, you know, I get so confused sometimes myself because I jump too often the gun, so to speak. But I like to be more, you know, simple. And little by little, I try to explain the meaning of it, okay? So when you look at the picture I show you before, over here, for instance, we're talking about what? The body, the soul, and the spirit. The proof about the body, you have to understand, you got to read it in 1 Thessalonians 5:23 and Hebrews 4:12, where it says that the word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword, and he will go divided what? Body, soul, and spirit. So here is the explanation again that we are created by God, body, soul, and spirit. And like I said before, God allows us to understand some of the attributes for spiritual worship with him. When you look at the picture itself, you look over there, I'll look over the side, maybe you can see it. It says over there, carnal, and it tells you over there, it's in 1 Corinthians, okay, 1-3, we are carnal. But then over here is the natural, the soul, okay, and then comes the spiritual. Now, through the carnal, of our body, we have the sight, we have a smell, we have a hearing, we have a taste, and we have a touch. It's from the world around us, okay? Then, right in the middle, we have our memory, but through the sight, we have the imagination. And through the smell, we have our conscious. Through the hearing, we have a memory. Through the taste, we have a reason. And through the touch, we have an affection. And now comes very important point is this. In the middle, what is this? The spirit. Are we spirits? So what is it now? Now, the spirit over here, why do we have a spirit? Because we can have faith. Because remember I said the spirit? We have a spiritual fellowship with him. So we have to know who he is through faith and through hope. And have reverence to him through prayer and worship. That is very important, okay? So here is the spirit. Now, we have to understand also that when Adam and Eve were created, they were created, okay, in God's image. But yet in the same token, we have to also understand that they have a choice. God walked with them and talked to them. But then he has a statement he made over there about the fruit. You know, remember? I hope you remember the story about Adam and Eve. When he says, okay, you can eat from all the fruits, right? But one of the fruits you cannot eat is from the knowledge, from good and bad. And here comes the problem with a lot of people who understand why is it so important what God says about that fruit, okay? So let's go real quick to the understanding before I forget. The Spirit, when you go back to Zechariah 12:1, it says over there also, so here God breathed in man, okay, and man became a living soul, okay? But in Zechariah 1:2-7 over there, God formed the Spirit. So here to come the question, when we have a spirit, why do we have a spirit? Are we spirit beings? Or what are we? And here where a lot of people get confused, okay, when we talk about a spirit, because I talk to some people and they say, well, when I die, that's what that statement is, okay, excuse me, when I die, then my spirit, let me go like this, excuse me, my spirit will just move around and I can look for a nice place to live. That is his philosophy. I said, oh? And I said, okay, if you believe that, I asked him about, what do you believe, what God is, okay? And he says, well, I don't know, he says, but that's how he believes. Other people, like I said before, they don't believe there's a heaven, a hell, but they understand the earth. Now we have to understand, when you're talking about the body is tangible. The soul and the spirit is not. You cannot see it, you cannot feel it. And in the same token, as time will go by, I explain to you, God is the same way. Now, he was at wait a moment now. Well, you have to understand what it really means when it says in Genesis 2:7, and the Lord formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostril the breath of life, and man became what? A living being. So human beings are living beings. They are not spiritual beings. Angels are spiritual beings. That is true. And God is the spirit. So that is the difference when you look at the scripture, the meaning of it. The Bible says also that, excuse me, I'm tickling my mouth, okay, I'm in my throat. We have to understand the difference between the angels, who are created beings, and God. God is not a spirit. God is spirit. The difference is over here, the meaning is, excuse me, God is eternal. That means that there's no beginning and no end. The angels are spirits, are a spirit. A spirit means actually, but when you look at it also in the Greek, is a intelligent created being. That is a spirit. But God is spirit. Two different things. No beginning, no end. But in other words, when there's a beginning, right? That means the angels has what? Everlasting life. God only has eternal life. We are created from the dirt. We have everlasting life. That is a beginning, but no ending. Some people don't believe that is an ending. Some people believe when you die, this is over with. No. We are created in God's image, so he has a purpose. But we have to understand that it's a time from coming and a time from going. And it's very important to remember that, because I've talked to a lot of people and they just live. Well, I talked even to my family, and one of them said, you know what? I'll find out what happened to me when I die. He said, wait a moment. That's too late. God gave you a certain time. The clock is ticking for everybody. Everybody have a chance, and it's up to us to find out, if we want to, who is God. Is there really a God? Well, if you look at the nature, somebody has to build, have touched something. It's like a watchmaker, okay? A watch. When you look at a watch, who makes a watch? Must be a watchmaker. So somebody started something and makes something. And a lot of people sometimes don't understand it and they want to accept because they just don't want to think about it. Yet, in the same token, we know that there's a time from coming and time from going. They will die, general speaking, okay? And God told us that. In the beginning, God told Adam about the fruit of the tree, not to eat. And he says, the day you will eat of that fruit, of the knowledge of good and evil, you will surely die. Now, may I remind you, in the Bible, generally speaking, when it comes to that phrase, death, death means eternal separation from God. Eternal separation from God. When you go back to Romans 5 to 12, it says the same thing. By what man the human race is what? Condemned. That means eternally separated from God. But out of love, God's love at least, he gave us a chance. And his plan already from the beginning, he's talking about a redeemer. If you look at the Old Testament, even the Jewish people are looking for a redeemer, a Messiah. And later in the New Testament, it was explained, Christ came on the scene, okay? So those little things I'm going to share and go more in detail. But we have to understand, first of all, God is holy, and he says, I'm the only God. So that's the purpose, okay? And he wants you to know that he is Almighty God, period. Now, he created us with the Spirit in order to what? To worship him and fellowship with him. But through sin, that particular part of our spirit is dead. That's what the Bible says. Our spirit towards God is dead. We do what we like to do. That's why you have so many religions. They do, or they follow somebody else, or some other God. But remember what I said to you before in Isaiah? God says, I'm the only God. So we have to be careful when we talk to people or what we plan to do in our life, that we realize there is a time coming and going, there is a God who created us, and he has a purpose. May I say something real quick before I forget? Okay? When I say, like in the scripture, let's say in Romans 5, where God says to Adam, through one man, sin came, and the human race is condemned. There's a little thing you have to remember. Whosoever will, the Bible says, can know him. With other words, when the baby died, for instance, that person, the baby, has no chance yet, right? Understand? But when the person comes to the age of accountability, then when the clock, you know, start for that person to make a decision to say yes or no to God. With other words, everybody who has the capability to make a choice is up that to individual where that individual will spend eternity. And I hope you understand what I'm trying to get across. That is a reason. If you even study a little bit, time. In the old days, like Adam, he was 930 years. What happened now? The average person is what? 70 years. There is a timetable. One of the main reasons why God did it, He has a time limit for us to live, and after that He will start all over again with a new world and a new heaven. But in the same token, He has to judge us. And the main reason is because sin came in the world through Satan. And we have a choice now through His word and through other, you know, circumstances to find Him if we wanted to. So think about it first, okay? And I'd like to stop right now just to be sure that you understand what I'm going to take it across. That is a responsibility for every person who are old enough, may I use the word, okay, to make a choice. So I ask you, please think about it, and I go a little more deeper and more in you know, the explanation about more about body, soul, and spirit, so you will understand that there is a chance, and God doesn't want anyone to perish, but we have a choice. And He's willing to show Himself to you through the Spirit. So I will say till next time. God bless you. I thank you for your time. And like I said, have a good time. Good day. Bye-bye now.